There were the political leaders, the G7 leaders, gathered in Birmingham. And I heard firsthand from Gordon Brown, who was there as our Chancellor, that when the delegates got up that morning in their hotel, surrounding them were thousands of trade unionists, but particularly Christians, Catholic, Anglicans, Methodists, Baptists, surrounding them in a kind of silent thing with waving banners. The Jubilee campaign, Gordon Brown said to me later, they were saying, the people, the delegates were saying, who are these people? Where did they come from? The church had arrived in great number. They'd become politically active. And then Linda Chalker was followed by, when Labour came to power, by another remarkable woman. And women feature in this a great deal. Claire Short, who you will have met many times indeed, a lapsed Catholic. She often called herself a cultural Catholic, but actually her faith was actually very real in her life. She was actually initially very worried about focusing on debt because she said, you know, countries have got to honour their commitments. In the same way, if you and I fall into debt, no one's going to give us remission. The banks certainly won't. So why do we expect that nations should be any different? But when she saw the issue of what was actually happening, in the case of Britain, for every £3 we gave away, one we were extracting in terms of servicing the debt. It was a colossal imposition. So, but what it did do was to emphasize that the churches had a remarkable contribution to make. It was that with that kind of background that I started to visit parts of the Anglican Communion, and I began to see the world through the eyes of the poor. Sudan, which we've been to five times, particularly impressed us. Not merely in terms of the clash between Islam and Christianity, because in many respects, the two faiths in many areas were getting on extremely well. But we're able to see what poverty was doing to people, and particularly women, and we'll come on to that in a moment. So I began to see as an archbishop that I had a power of advocacy that I hadn't begun to exploit. And I think we as Christians ought to realize that being an advocate for the poor is a very important thing to do. We can do it at many different levels. So I started to do that. I remember a dear friend, a Christian MP, said to me one day, he said, when you go on your travels and you step out of the plane and the officials are there to greet you, do you ever ask them who speaks for the women and the children? And I had to say to Andrew, this MP, no, I never thought of it, but from now on I would do it. And when we stepped out of the plane and people said, I'm the minister for this, who speaks for the very poor? How can we hear their voices? And this actually is quite an electrifying question. The importance, though, of advocacy on behalf of the invisible poor took a very interesting form when in 1997, a World Bank official phoned my office and asked if I would be willing to speak to the new president of the World Bank, Jim Wolferson. He was a successful businessman, already making waves in the bank through his hands-on approach, his dynamism, and of course, he was also making all kind of waves because not every person in the bank wanted that kind of president. But he met me, and out of that meeting came eventually, after the embryonic form, WFDD. But what was so impressive about him was his willingness to think outside the box, to approach a very strange, possible ally in the religious community when the bank is by nature secular, representing all the governments. But what brought home to Jim the importance of religious community was a visit he had just made to Tanzania. And he was talking to government officials and so on. And he realized, actually, that the bank was giving money to the government, but the churches and religious communities on the ground were doing so much in terms of health, aid, gender issues, farming. In fact, my days when I was Bishop of Bath and Wells, it was from Somerset Farms that we were sending cows to Africa, to Tanzania in particular. And so Jim started to say, why are we processing all this World Bank grant through the government and ignoring the extensive religious networks of the country? And it was really out of a discussion over the phone that we hit upon the idea that we would bring together representatives of nine world religions to Lambeth Palace to see if a partnership could be forged between the World Bank and the religious communities. Very unlikely bedfellows,